Hello, chess family. It's me, National Master Jesse James, and today we're taking a look at game number 9 of Bobby Fischer's My 60 Most Memorable Games. This is Walter versus Fischer, Betwixt the Cup and the Lip. I love this name just because, well, whenever you're about to take a sip of anything, there's a little bit of joy in you, right? You're going to get whatever you're drinking. And, well, between that is a little space there. And, well, sometimes something can happen between that space when you're about to take a sip of whatever you're drinking. And in this game, this is exactly what happens when Fischer is playing against Walter. Walter gets a very good game against Fischer. He's attacking him. He has a good opening against Fischer in the Nydorf. In the middle game, he's just crushing him. And unfortunately, betwixt the cup and the lip, Fischer is able to get a draw out of him and stop him in what looks like an easily winning position. Well, with that being said, let's take a look and see how strong Fischer's psychology is in never giving up. Remember, that's one of the things I love about this game, is a strong psychology, and Alexander Alekhine says it the best. Psychology is the most important factor in chess. Let's see how Bobby Fischer, a master of this, goes ahead and takes advantage of it. Here we see a good game of a Nydorf. So e4, c5, knight f3, d6, d4, c takes, knight f6, knight c3, a6. Of course, Bobby Fischer chooses to play his beloved Nydorf. He's playing with the black pieces. Bishop g5, the main line right here, developing and attacking the knight, saying, hey, I want to make some double pawns here. Pawn e6, not today. Pawn f4, I like this move. Grab space on the king side, threatening e5 ideas, but also you can see that the queen's going to be jumping out here pretty soon, saying we're going to have some good development here, and also I'm going to be castling queenside. This game's going to get crazy. Knight b to d7, castles queenside, queen c7, bishop to d3, and pawn to b5. We are still in mainline theory, and here, bishop takes on f6, the main move. For anybody asking or thinking, hey, can we play pawn to e5? e5 is a very strong move, just not right now. Remember, always take a look at your opponent's ideas, and well, here, Bobby Fischer would just play the simple move, bishop b7, and now has a very good position. It looks like the double attack is going to work, but unfortunately now it is you who is going to be losing a pawn. Well, I guess you could play e takes d6, bishop takes d6, but here again, Fischer's just doing good. You can also even just play bishop takes on f3 here too, and after pawn takes, well, you can just move your bishop to take this little exchange right here. I don't know if you like these things, but some people do. Anyways, back to the game. Pawn to b5, bishop takes f6, this is main line here, and there's actually only one good move here for black. Alright, first pop quiz of the game. Remember, I do encourage you to push pause. Black to move, there's one. G takes f6, bishop takes f6, and knight takes f6. Which one is the best here? If you're a Nydorf player, you would know this without even looking at the position. What's the best way to play here? All right, hopefully you found it. Here it's going to be knight takes f6. Other ways will give black or white the advantage here. For instance, if you play g takes on f6, well, here white just has a very good game because the pawn structure is all messed up. You're not necessarily doing very bad right now, but castling kingside is not even an option. And in chess, you always want to keep your options open. So, yeah, this is just a better position here for white. All right, what about bishop takes on f6? It looks like a very good move because, hey, aren't you taking back? You're not giving yourself double pawns, and you're attacking the knight? Well, unfortunately here, you're falling for a very basic trap in these kind of games. And, well, although the knight's undefended, now e5 is working, attacking the bishop. Hey, wait a second, don't we just play bishop b7 like last time? Well, here we have a very nice tactic of knight c takes b5 here. Can't we just take on f3? You can, but then knight takes c7 checks, you're losing back the material. Pawn takes over here, rook takes over here, and taking on d1 is just too slow over here. Wait a second, can we just take? Of course you can take, knight takes, you have the same idea now. And queen c5 is going to be the best move here, but I hear someone saying, hey, can't we just go queen b6, guarding the bishop, but also attacking the knight? You can, but you missed the idea of this. It's queen takes b7 here, and after queen takes back, knight takes d6 check for an easily winning position. After this, well, your bishop's being attacked, you're about to lose your queen, and look at these beautiful passed pawns over here, three of them. I would do this idea with even giving up a piece here for white. So with having the same amount of pieces, this is again a very easy winning position here for white. All right, back to the game. Here, obviously, after bishop takes on f6, we should just take back with the knight here. And here, e5 will not work again because if e5 gets played, well, again, bishop b7 gets played. And because of that tempo, it just won't work here. Does the knight takes b5 work here? Fortunately, after knight takes b5, a takes b5, knight takes b5 here. Well, now we could just play queen b6 here, because the bishop is now guarding on d6, so there is no more fork here. Very, very important thing to know for you Nydorf players. All right, well, back to the game. Here again, we'll go back to the line where bishop takes on f6 gets played. Knight takes, rook to e1. Here, Walther is ready for the attack. He's going to be pushing in the center here. Bishop to b7, and also, let's do it. King to b1. Just like Grishuk says, I don't know why we play king b1 whenever you castle queenside in the Sicilian, but you must play it. So Walter must have heard his words, even though he's a little older than him, and went ahead and played king to b1 here. Rook to c8, a very common idea here. A lot of times people think in the Nydorf, if once they castle, I'm going to get the attack, and you are correct thinking that. With that being said, a lot of Nydorf players will just go ahead and keep their king in the center, because it's very hard to open up the center. And even if you do get to open up the center successfully, then they will castle, and then the whole game starts over again. So black gets a lot of good counterplay down the c-file over here. Well, not this game. As you can see, Walter gets a really nice attack here. G4, let's do it. Let's get for g5. Maybe f5 is in the cards. And here, unfortunately for Fischer, he goes ahead and plays knight to d7, g5, knight to b6. A very common move here. Unfortunately, this just gives Walter its big advantage. White to move. What do you play here to get a good attacking chance against Fischer? All right, hopefully you found this one. This one was not too hard, I believe. Here, the move was to play pawn to f5 with a very strong attack. And here, well, what do you play here as Fischer? Fischer goes ahead and plays pawn to e5, trying to keep the position close, which makes sense because, well, if you open this game up, don't you just get a strong attack? Yes, you do. After knight takes f5, you got some weak squares over here. Knight takes g7, knight takes e7. This is becoming quite a headache for you. Unfortunately, for Fischer, though, well, after f5 here, there's really just no good move. He plays e5 here, and again, white to move. Can you find the move here? You've made the first good move, but you got to keep pushing forward here. What do you play? All right, there was a few different ideas here. I hear someone saying, is it knight to e6? Although I give you kudos for finding a nice idea, this just does not work. And here it's just a simple refutation of pawn takes, pawn takes. Hey, queen f7 checks being threatened. Yes, it is, but there's too many different ways that black can get a good game in here. Computer's giving king to d8 as the best move, but I can say that you can look at rook f8, you can look at bishop takes g5. Maybe not the best bishop takes g5 as queen h5 check is coming, but either way, this is just not the best way to proceed. So what is the best way? Here, hopefully you found it. It was pawn to f6. Now, not only does this attack the bishop, but you're going to see here as it just imprisons the kingside pieces. After pawn takes, bishop back to f8. And again, I hear someone asking, hey, can't we just take the knight over here? Taking the knight will lead to very bad positions, and these are transposing. As after e takes on d4, white to move, knight to d5 gets played, opening up the center, and well, you're just in a bad position. Here, you're attacking both the bishop and the queen, so if you don't take back, you're just going to be losing it. But taking back is just as bad as bishop takes, pawn takes, and now you're going to be losing this position quite easily here. I don't even think Fischer can withstand this type of pressure. All right, back to the game. And so, pawn takes, bishop to f8. And as I said, now we're in Fischer prisons over here. We're just, our bishop's bad, our rook's bad. And here, white to move, keep pushing forward, keep making threats. What do you play here? Hopefully you found it again. Knight to d5. What's good in one variation is usually good in all variations. And so, knight takes, pawn takes. Now the king is stuck in the center here. King to d8, trying to get out the pin. Maybe I can take here on d4. Unfortunately, Walther has a good idea here. And he plays knight c6 check. Bishop takes, pawn takes, queen takes. It seems weird here to give up a pawn and also an exchange whenever you're attacking. But here, it is actually a very good idea because we have what's called opposite color bishops. Now, I know a lot of you guys know that when it's opposite color bishops, these can be very drawish. But that's only when it's opposite color bishops in the endgame. When you have the rooks and queens on the board, the game becomes very volatile or very aggressive. And there's plenty of ways to win in this position. All right, bishop to e4. Queen to b6. Queen to h5 with a nice double threat here. Hopefully you see it. Here Fischer is being attacked with queen takes on f7 and also queen takes on e5. So even if you do play rook c7 here, queen takes e5 gets played and your position is going to be opened up. So Fischer just says, you know what, I'm going to have to give away this pawn, but I might as well give it away and get my king to safety. So king c7 gets played. Nice little tempo move here. Bishop f5 attacking the rook. Rook to d8, and now queen takes on f7 check. King b8. Here it is a plus 4 position against Fischer. And, well, maybe it's not the easiest position to win, but I would definitely prefer white in this position. I mean, yes, Fischer has these good pawns, but look at, the pieces. This is where the main advantage is. And this is where Walther starts faltering and does not play the best moves. All right, queen to e6, queen c7, rook e3. Of course, Walther wants to bring his rook over here to attack this queen. And, well, bishop h6, developing with a threat, rook c3, and queen b7. An important move here. If you stay on the dark squares here, for instance, and play something like queen to b6, well, this bishop comes back to this long diagonal with a very, very strong threat. Rook takes d6, rook c6. Oof. It just gets worse and worse, and you can see even queen d5 ideas here. So that's why the queen actually goes to b7, just to prevent this bishop from going to its best square. Well, d6 is now being threatened, so... Oh, f7 got played real quick. Here, going ahead and attacking the bishop and threatening this d6 pawn. And actually, I want to go back real quick and just say, hey, is there a reason why we can't take on d6 here? Well, if rook takes on d6... You just missed it. Queen to h1 check. You just got back rank checkmate. I know somebody was probably asking, hey, is that a free pawn? It is not. Be careful when your opponent gives you free pawns. So f7 got played, pushing the pawn forward and also attacking this bishop over here. Of course, Fischer's not going to let anything fall. Bishop to g7. Again, we can't take on d6 because of the back rank checkmate. Rook to d3. Now we could take this pawn because the rooks are now connected. And here we go. Bishop f8. No pawn left behind. The bishop just comes back to guard this d6 pawn. And queen takes on e5 here. A very nice move by Walther. Now this goes into an endgame where I wish he had played a little bit better. He does play well, but again, he just falters it right at the end. Just right betwixt the cup and the lip. Queen takes e5. D takes. Rook takes. Check. King to a7. And rook d7. Just winning the queen back. All right, pawn to h5, a nice move here, trying to let the rook out into the game. Rook takes b7, king takes b7, and pawn c3. From now on, well, white's going to be doing a good job, but at the most critical moment, just lets it falter. And pawn c3 is a very good move as the king goes over to the center just to put pressure on the pawn. Also, these pawns are all on light squares, which means these guys are targets. This pawn on f7 is one of the key factors. But with that being said, easier said than done. It's really hard to get control over this f8 square because, well, we have a light square bishop and they have dark square. Why does that matter? That means we have two pieces defending the square and you've only got one. So you'd have to bring your king over all the way over to, like, f6 for something to happen. Or really even, like, e8 or g8. So here we go. King c7. Fischer knows that the most important pawn in this position is the f7 pawn. So he doesn't mind giving away a pawn just for this to happen. Rook a8. King d6, check, king e7, and here, rook e6, check. King takes on f6, rook takes on e5, pawn to b4, and pawn takes on b4. Not the worst position, not the worst thing to play here, but probably something like c4 would be a little bit better. But I can definitely understand Walther. He probably thinks, hey, after pawn takes here, this should be just an easy endgame. I mean, you're up two extra pawns here, the bishop finally gets free. I mean, look at this rook. He's been waiting around the whole game, and only now is he going to be able to jump in. And this last pawn is on the light square, so there are some weaknesses. With that being said, if Fischer can force off the rooks, there is some drawing chances. So, let's see what happens here. Pawn to h3, king f6, rook b5, bishop d6, bishop b4. Of course, Walther's going to be pushing these pawns on the queen side here, so Fischer has to act fast. Rook e8, rook f5, check. King over to g7. Of course, we can't take on h5 so simply because, well, your bishop will fall. Bishop f3, rook e1 check, king to c2, rook to f1. I'd be more than happy to trade off, especially just the rooks, because remember, this will help us get us good drawing chances. Rook to d5. Is this a good endgame? Should we go into rook and pawn endgame? I hear these are all draws. Of course not. This would be an easy win for white here. The bishops are the only true way to try and get a draw in this position. And unfortunately right now, well, Fischer has a very good idea. It looks like it's just going to be rook takes d6, but Fischer finds this nice move. Can you find it? Here, rook to f2 check. And now you see that you can't go to c3 or b3 without rook takes on f3 check. And, well, after that, you'll just be down a piece. And if you bring your king backward, well, let's say back to b1, then you can just go ahead and add these checks in between here. Well, I guess Walther was very confident in this position, so he plays rook d2, and Fischer must have been so excited and elated and just takes on d2 check real quick. So king takes on d2 and pawn to a5. Here at this point, it's very, very hard for black, for white here. White has to walk a very fine line. Don't get me wrong. If Magnus is playing this, I'm sure this would be quite easy. But playing against a person of higher strength, these endgames can be very tricky. And h4 is a nice move here because now the bishop can always defend it. So what is black's plan? Can you tell me? Well, hopefully you understand that this is a very volatile position because, well, black has the idea of trading off this bishop for both pawns or blockading. Now, if he could blockade these pawns, it should be an easy draw. If he could even trade off his bishop for both pawns, it is still a draw. How is that possible? Well, with the bishop and pawn and king versus king, this is actually a drawn position. Because the bishop does not control the same color in the corner over here, it is a draw. The king can just run back and forth. You're more than welcome to go to a chessboard and put this in there and see if you can win the position. Unfortunately, you will find that there's just no good way to play. So, where does Fischer head his king toward? Well, this king is going to head over here toward the queen side so he can stop the pawns. Let's see how he does it. King to d3, king to f6, king c4, king to e7, king b5, king d7, and here he goes wrong with pawn to a4 here. Unfortunately, the move here was to play pawn to b4, and apparently this is just a nice winning position here. As after, king c7, king a5, we have to win this b6 square. This is one of the most important squares to win. King b8, b5, and bishop to a3, stopping the pawn from moving forward. Now, if you play the pawn to b6, well, things are not so terrible here, but you can just move your bishop back and forth. But this is just not going to work. Remember, this is the winning line here. And so after b6, once this is won, the game is over. So king c8, and here there's a few different ways to win. King a6, or you can simply just move your bishop. You can just move your bishop back to g2 and get them on zugzwang, so they have to move the bishop. Bishop goes to c5, king to a4, bishop a3, bishop f1. Again, if the king tries to block over here, well, bishop to e2, and, well, which one moves? If the bishop moves, we get to push the pawn. If the king moves, then we just win the game. Again, king c8, king e7, king a7, bishop c5, and now the idea is to get this pawn protected, and then we can play king e8. So simple chess. a4, if you play bishop to b4 right away, check wins the game. So you have to keep the bishop right here. And here, black will play something like, I don't know, let's just say bishop to d4, and after a5, now king e8 can successfully get played here, and the game is going to be all but over. But again, a4 got played, and what do you know? I'm very surprised that this is just a drawing move here. And again, Fischer must have been so happy about this because it's one pawn versus three, especially with two passed pawns here. You think this would be a lot easier. King c7, pawn b4, king b8, pawn to a5, and here you can see that the pawn is not getting to this b6 square so easily. King a7, king c4, bishop back, pawn to b5, and now it is definitely a draw here because, well, the pawn getting to b6 allows the king to get to good positions. And even bishop e1 here is just an easy draw. For instance, after bishop e1, how do you defend this pawn? You can't. So you have to play something like a6 here, and now you can see the easy idea of blockading on the dark squares. Here, Fischer plays a little bit different here. He goes ahead and plays bishop f2, bishop e2, bishop e3, king d3, and then finally goes to d2 here. b6 check, king b7, king a4, king to c6, bishop b5 check, and king c5. Game over here. This is now just a drawn position. Even if you do try to push your pawn forward with, let's just say, b7 here, the bishop just comes back to f4, and you can't move this pawn forward without allowing the dark squares to fall, and the bishop can just run back and forth here. Pretty much at the end, the king will come to a7 or b8, and the bishop can just slide back and forth, so there's no way to make progress. If you try to run to the king side, no avail. The pawn can always be defended by the bishop, which can still defend these squares if need be. Unfortunately for Walther, he had to take a draw in this position. Well, guys, I hope you enjoyed this game. We'll see you in the next one.